Hello, boys and girls. This is your old friend, the Dreamfinder, here to set off on another grand circle tour of the Magic Kingdom.
The future is bright indeed. We're all of us dreaming of the better days ahead, and a part of your bright new future could be a move to where the magic lives in the greater Orlando area of Florida. One of the biggest decisions you'll make when considering a move is selecting a realtor who can successfully match you with the right home in the right location at the right price. Victor Naraki is the realtor who can help you make the move you've always wanted to. Whether you're a first-time homeowner or looking to move near Disney World, Victor is in your corner. If you are looking for an experienced real estate agent covering all of Central Florida, please visit DisneyAtYourDoorstep.com today and find out just why you should work with Victor. I encourage you to create a free, no-obligation account on his website. By doing so, you'll unlock the website's full potential and be able to enter specific criteria, save listings, and browse new properties sent to your email. Visit DisneyAtYourDoorstep.com today or visit his Facebook page, Victor Naraki Realtor. And don't forget to tell him the Grand Circle Tour podcast sent you.
The Disneyland Limited, now leaving for a Grand Circle Tour of the Magic Kingdom. All passengers board.
Star Tours announces the boarding of the Endor Express. All passengers, please prepare for immediate boarding.
Please stand clear of the doors. Por favor, manténganse alejado de las puertas.
To those guests who've just joined us, welcome. For those of you standing, please hold on to the handrails throughout our journey and stay clear of the doors.
Please keep your hands, arms, and legs inside the train and remain seated at all times. Hang on to them hats and glasses, because this here's the wildest ride in the wilderness.
I am Sam the American Eagle, and I am proud to introduce the Grand Circle Tour Podcast, a celebration of Disney parks, but mostly the American ones. I really like these guys.
All aboard, passengers, and welcome to another episode of the Grand Circle Tour Podcast. My name is Dan Hansen, and I will be your host and conductor today as we take you on a tour around all things Disney. I'm giggling. You guys will find out why I'm giggling in a second. But with me today, I have my absolute favoritest co-host in the history of all co-hosts, Skipper Jay. How are you today? And what's up?
Aloha, giggling Dan. I am fantastic. What's up with me this week? So I told you guys, I thought Magic Band Plus was really cool, but I was going to wait until I saw one that like spoke to me. One that if I'm going to spend the extra money to get some flashing lights in my Magic Band, it has to be something I really want. And by gum, they've done it. There is a Tower of Terror Magic Band. It's not on Shop Disney yet, but the second I can get my little skipper paws on it, that's the one.
It is pretty cool. Jay sent me a picture. It's, how would you describe it? The twirling black and white.
It's the old, it's like from the Twilight Zone, that swirling pattern you see in the ride and on the show. And it does have Mickey and Minnie on one side. But But the other side has a really cool, like, Art Deco looking version of the building.
Very cool.
I can't wait. That's I'm finally getting me a Magic Band Plus.
Did I tell you which one Connor got when we were there? He got, I was very impressed. You could tell he's the son of a Disney fan. He got Orange Bird.
Nice, good choice.
Yeah. John, do you know who Orange Bird is?
I have no idea who Orange Bird is.
All right, we're going to introduce John in a second. But anyway, yes, he got Orange Bird. I was very, very proud of him. So
I found one for Chris. Now they also have because he's a vet, they have an Army Green Magic Band Plus. And so it looks like we're both going to get them.
Very cool. We Chris sent us a picture that she got an Orange Bird stuffed animal, and Connor got the same one. And I told Chris on our group chat that if you scratch his butt, he smells like oranges, which is true. And Holly replies back with, "If you scratch your son's butt, he smells like oranges." So yes, it's very cool. The stuffed animal of Orange Bird.
He knows how much you enjoy Soarin', so he's going to spray that orange spray for you.
All right, my what's up? A couple weeks post D23. But Jay, what'd you think? Did you think were you disappointed in the announcements?
I want to do another episode about this because I was so underwhelmed. And with Universal's Epic Universe just 2.5 years away from opening, I don't think Disney realizes the rolling boulder coming at them like in Indiana Jones.
I would agree with that, and I think everyone would agree with that. They have some big problems if they don't start
Their lunch money is going to get taken away for a while.
I'm already getting it from my family that they want to go to Universal next year and not Disney. So
I'm excited to be a Universal Pass holder in a few months. I already know Chris is going to like it more than Disney.
Yeah.
But they have rides like Hagrid's and Velocicoaster. And with this new park coming, I cannot wait for the Universal Monster Land.
Yeah. Seems very cool.
But it's the newest theme park in Orlando. It's going to be the most technically advanced theme park in Orlando. It's across the street from the convention center. You'll be able to go into the hub for free, purchase admission to one land if you want.
Yep. Did you happen to listen to Jim Hill's podcast a couple weeks ago?
Of course. I never miss Jim Hill.
They did a really good job. They had a guest on there that knew a lot about it. So, passengers, if you want to hear more about it, go tune in to the Disney Dish podcast with Jim Hill.
No, don't, because that makes Dan and I sound like experts after listening.
We steal their content all the time, shamelessly.
Appropriate.
We give them credit. That's as professionals do. All right. So we, Jay is my only regular tour guide here today, but we have a special guest tour guide. John Rieder is with us. John, a little history about John. John has been my personal best friend since what, John? Second grade?
Second grade. We met in kindergarten, but we didn't become best friends until second grade.
So I hated him in kindergarten. He was a jerk.
Right. A good 40 years.
Yeah, a good 40 years. Holy cow, John, don't say that loud. Cool. We don't talk about ages on this podcast. But
Dan, this is to get off our lawn show. Let's be honest.
Yeah. So I've had this idea for a while. I needed the right person to have on the show. But you have two types of people that listen to the show. Mostly, it's people like myself and Jay, who are the crazy Disney fans that want to hear about what's going on and talk about our favorite things and blah, blah, blah. But you're also going to have our second largest audience are people that are planning a trip to Disney and are trying to, you know, find out what to do and where to stay and what the best things are and things like that. Over the last, I don't know, 3-4 years, I think we all can agree that that planning for a Disney vacation has gotten a lot harder.
Oh, so, Dan, from the time we started the show to now, it's an entirely different experience.
I know. And I think that's one of the reasons why we have become a little popular is people are interested in hearing this stuff because it is a job. It could become a full-time job if you really want that perfect vacation. So anyway, so John, who is not the biggest Disney fan, reached out to me and said, hey, I'd like to either stay at, we'll talk about it in a second, but two different hotels. And we were chatting back and forth. And I just casually said, hey, are you going to get Disney Genie Plus? And John replied with some obscenities, but what the you know what is Genie Plus? And I said, John, I need you on the show, and we got to talk to you as a non-Disney fan about planning a trip just to see how difficult this is. So, John, I appreciate you coming on. I had to drag him on.
Right.
John knows a lot about my life, more than anyone. Yeah. The only part of my life he doesn't know is this part of my life. So he's looking at me crazy.
I am going to mute Dan's mic and just let you tell Dan stories for the next 45 minutes.
I could tell Dan stories. I think I still have my best man speech from his wedding where I actually listed, I think, 20 and told him, you know, for a dollar or buy me a shot and I'll tell you one of the stories on this list.
What's your Venmo?
First of all, no one's buying you a shot at my wedding. I paid for it all. So
take me to the bar and give
John,
me a shot.
We can mute his mic and I can title the episode this one time at Dan Camp.
Nice. That's a good one. And we got the title for the show. All right. Anyway, All right, so let's start, John. John, give us a little history. How often have you been to Disney? What's your relationship with the Disney parks?
I've been to Disney. I only started going to Disney in my 20s. We didn't have the money to go to Disney as kids, so I never went to Disney. And then in my 20s, I went and with other adults. And we drank our way around Epcot and had a grand old time. And it was a great time. And then I've been a few more times now since I have my daughter. She's 13. We went for her 5th birthday. We went for her 10th birthday. And now we wanted to plan just an impromptu couple days over Thanksgiving. And I can say that from the time I went at 21, 22 until now, each time I have gone has been progressively worse. At the beginning, it was great. I absolutely loved it. And then the little changes here and there, as I keep going, it makes it harder. Dan knows, we talk about this. When I talk about going to Disney, it's a vacation for me. And a vacation should be relaxing. And I should be able, I want to be able to walk into Disney and go up to a ride and, yeah, I'll wait on a line for an hour, but go on that ride. Go to another ride, just kind of casually go through my day. In order to have a good time at any of the parks, I feel like I have to have a strict itinerary of 9 a.m. this ride. I have to make sure I'm off that ride by this time because I got a fast pass for this ride.
No more fast pass, John. No more fast pass. That's less than one. All right. Okay. So,
see, last time I went, there was fast pass, and that was only 3 years ago.
Yep. That is true. Then
much things change, and you can still do that. You can still go ride to ride and get in line whenever you want. They're trying to, and I'm using air quotes, make things easier, and it's not.
Yeah. Well, there's reasons behind it that we could get into as we go through it. But you're right, John. Me, as an Uber planner and someone who likes structure, that's why I love Disney. And that's what makes it more fun to me. But for most people that are crazy like me, a vacation is supposed to be relaxing. And I can see and we can sense by our Disney community that it's getting harder and harder to do that. So we'll talk about that a little bit more. So let's get into the basics, John. So let's start where you started with me. John asked me, hey, where should I stay? And here's what I narrowed it down to. John, you want to talk about what you've narrowed it down to?
Three different places, three different hotels I want to stay. One of the value resorts, the pop culture, whatever resort.
Pop Century.
Pop Century, okay. The Port Orleans and the Caribbean Beach Resort. And which one, I asked Dan, which does he recommend of those? Actually, I started with just the two and then we went to Caribbean Beach after.
Jay, what do you say?
Out of those three, I would pick Port Orleans. It's a little more relaxing. It's not Disney bombardment every 2 seconds like at Pop Century. So when you step out of the parks, you're getting away from Mickey and all his pals. You get kind of, you're in the bubble, but you're not, it's not just coming at you.
Okay.
Yeah, and I agree. That's what I told John, too. And listen, a lot of it has to do with price, too. So, but if you're willing to pay the extra money, you're going to have a more peace and quiet.
Yeah.
It's a difference of from the pop resort to Caribbean Beach. It's a difference of $1,000 over four nights.
Yeah. And you may need that $1,000 for other things that we'll talk about.
But we're actually leaning closer toward Caribbean Beach only because of the parks that my daughter wants to go to. My daughter wants to go to Epcot and Hollywood. And Caribbean Beach has the gondola that goes to those two specific resorts. so it'd be easy transportation-wise to go grab the gondola, go.
I would say Caribbean Beach, that especially. I mean, so you guys don't have interest in Magic Kingdom this time. She kind of at that growing out of it phase.
She's kind of at that. Yeah, she's growing out of it at this point. Yeah, 13. So she's starting to grow out of it.
So I would say that the Skyliner, which most people go call gondolas, so you're not wrong for saying that. But the Skyliner is probably one of the better changes that Disney has made.
Yeah.
For someone that hasn't been there in a while, they see them, people are like, what's this all about? I personally love it. I think it's a great mode of transportation. I don't think too many people hate it. I don't know. What do you think, Jay? Right?
I'm fine with it. And I don't do heights very well anymore. I'm okay with it.
I don't do heights very... I'm nervous about it. I don't do heights very well, but...
You're only about 30 feet enclosed. Off the ground. Right. So yeah.
I can stand in the middle and I'll be fine.
Yeah, you get a good breeze. It's not hot like people always... when they would build it.
Get a killer view because you get to see stuff you would never normally get to see.
Right.
Yeah, so I agree. If you're willing to spend the extra $1,000 and that is not... that is not something you're going to be upset about, then that's a good place to stay because of the Skyliner.
Yeah. Well, it the way the money worked, it gradually went up. So we started with the Pop Century Resort. Then we were like, okay, well, maybe we'll do the Port Orleans. It's only a few $100 more. And then the Caribbean Beach is like, oh, it's only $300 more than that one. So we'll do the Caribbean Beach.
That's how they get you.
And next week he'll be staying at the Grand Floridian. Watch.
No, we're not going that far. My wife wanted to stay at the Polynesian, but we're definitely not doing the Polynesian.
I'm looking at a 3-night stay when we move to Florida. So our first night as a resident, we're going to be there just for 3 nights with 2 2-day tickets, not park hoppers, $2,400.
Right. That's crazy.
Crazy. Yeah. All right, so I agree that that's a good starting point of a hotel to stay at. So now, John, how many days in the parks are you going to be there? Have you narrowed that down?
Yeah, we're only going to do 2 days in the parks. So we're going to be there. We're going to leave Wednesday, the day before Thanksgiving. So we'll be flying in. We'll have Thanksgiving, the Friday after, and the Saturday, and then we'll fly back on Sunday. So we're only going to spend 2 days in the park, 1 day to just chill in the hotel.
Are you going to do the park on Thanksgiving?
I don't know. I'm not sure. What do you think? That's another question that I'm glad I have my crazy Disney friend that I can say, of those 3 days, is Thanksgiving going to be like completely packed? Is that like the worst possible day to go? I already know that Thanksgiving weekend is a busy weekend, but...
You couldn't pay me to go on Thanksgiving?
Right.
I mean, and this is where you're going to want to, we'll walk into the Genie Plus thing, but you expect your entire visit. And I mean, from the time you land at MCO, you're one of the busiest times of the year.
Right.
And so, I mean, just getting from the airport to your hotel is going to take about twice as long as it normally would.
Right.
Give me a couple seconds, Jay, take over for a second. Okay. I am pulling up touring plan crowd calendar.
I looked it up already, and I looked it up on a different app, and it's just all 4 days are completely red.
Yeah, but if you know that going into it, yes, it's frustrating, but it tempers your expectation because you're not going to get there and go, what?
Right. And this is going to be an impromptu kind of thing. We had a plan that we were going to do Disney every 5 years with our daughter, our 5th, 10th, 15th. And this was kind of a last-minute thing. So we're not trying to do everything in every park. Like, we go once every 5 years, we want to do everything in the park on that day because we're not going to be there for a few years. So we want to get the entire experience of Magic Kingdom. We're going there this time. We're going to be like, we'll ride a few rides. We'll see what we can get on.
Casual mindset. That's definitely the way to go.
As casual as possible. We're not going to be disappointed if there's things that we miss out on because we can come back. Maybe we'll come back in another
years. I mean, expect the newer things like Star Wars and Ratatouille and Guardians to be
out there. That's the other part of this whole equation is that those two parks in particular have new attractions, right? You have right. not seen Star Wars, right?
No, I have not. And honestly, I'm a big Star Wars fan, but this trip is for my daughter, and right. she's not a big Star Wars fan. So if
yeah.
we don't get to see it, I'm not going to be destroyed.
John, do you know what Thanksgiving date is? Is it the 24th?
The 24th, yeah.
All right, so let me just tell you a little thing. So Hollywood Studios is a 9 out of 10 on Thanksgiving. It's an 8 out of 10 on Friday and an 8 out of 10 on Saturday. Right. Epcot is an 8 out of 10 on Thanksgiving, a 9 out of 10 on Friday, and a 7 out of 10 on Saturday. So...
okay.
That's where you are.
And what are the park hours for those days? Because we know about dinner time, people are going to start to leave those parks and head back to their hotels, do
true.
Their Thanksgiving right. thing.
True. And I could tell you by hour. It looks like, and this isn't official yet because Disney does change their hours about 30 days in advance. But projections is for Thanksgiving, Epcot to close at 8 and Hollywood Studios to close at 8, which is a little bit earlier, and it makes sense because they're going to have their cast members go home a little earlier. Where Friday it's open till 9 and Epcot's open till 10 okay. projected. So, you know, that's something to think about too.
And staying at a Disney hotel, you will get early entry. It's only a half hour, but
it makes a big deal.
It's a huge difference, yeah. I got to go to do the Star Wars stuff for the first time last time, the new ride. And I waited I waited 2 hours in the full line, broke down, waited an extra half hour. If you're a Star Wars fan, don't miss it.
Yeah.
It is what we all wanted as kids.
Are you coming home Sunday, or is Saturday a possibility for the park?
Coming home Sunday. So Saturday is a possibility for the park.
Here's what I would do.
So
just off of the crowd calendar, I would skip Thanksgiving,
right?
I would do Friday and Saturday, and I would do Hollywood Studios on Friday and Epcot on Saturday, because out of mm-hmm. all of it, at least you're getting a 7 out of 10, which is at least the lowest at Epcot on Saturday.
So Friday Hollywood, I'm writing this down, I'm taking notes.
And the Disney hotels do they all do something for Thanksgiving dinner. So,
yeah.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. And that's another thing that you're going to have to do. I'm assuming you guys are going to want to have some kind of dinner on Thanksgiving night.
Right. We're going to want
it'll be very crowded that night because everyone will be going out to dinner
but
that night.
It is fun to have Thanksgiving dinner at Disney. I've done it.
Yeah.
Definitely. It's kind of a neat experience, especially since you don't have to cook and clean. That kind of makes it worth the crowd alone.
All right, so we planned your park days. All right, so now, because you're only going to be there 2 days, now we got to talk about Genie Plus. So
Before you give me Genie Plus, just a quick question. Like, the ride that I want to do
is
the Guardians ride at Epcot.
Yep.
If I get the early entry on that Saturday and just run straight to that ride, what is my weight going to be on a 7 out of 10 day?
You can't for Guardians.
Yeah. I mean, no.
There's two options for Guardians that you're going to have. You're either going to try to get in to a, what they call a board. What is it? A boarding pass, a boarding group, to what they call a boarding group, which you have to do at 7 a.m. Is it 7 a.m. still, Jay?
I think 7 a.m. Yeah. It's still 7 a.m. starts at 7.
On the app, you're going to have to try for a boarding pass. And the boarding pass is not a guarantee to ride the ride, but it's they go in order. So boarding pass 1 gets called first, then boarding pass 2 gets called. And you could wait up to, I don't know, it could be half hour, hour after that, but that's when you have to get in line.
Now, Dan, real quick, not to interrupt, didn't they just drop Guardians and Genie Plus down to the a la carte menu where you don't have to pay for it?
No, they did not.
Okay, I thought I just read that.
No.
Okay.
So the other option is, John, is something called individual lightning lanes, right? This is where it gets confusing. Individual lightning lanes is the top one or two attractions in each park, which now has an extra cost per person just to ride that one ride.
And on so, holiday, expect about $18.
Yeah, it's probably going to be about $18 a person, probably. That's probably the highest that it will go, just to ride Guardians. So you could do that, and you could skip the chance of not getting a boarding pass, because the boarding passes go in seconds.
Right.
And
so if I pay my $18 per person, that guarantees I'm going to get to ride that ride sometime during the day.
And you get to pick the time, too.
Okay.
Which,
well, ish. You kind of get to ish pick the time.
Yeah, ish. But okay. When I went in August, every individual lightning lane that I paid for, I got exactly what I wanted right away. Now, maybe on Thanksgiving, it's going to be more crowded, and maybe everyone will have that same idea. So maybe it's a little bit harder. But you're not, if you want to go at 11 o'clock because you want to spend the rest of the afternoon drinking around the world, maybe you'll get 10 o'clock or 12 o'clock, but you'll get something like that. You're not going to have to wait until 9 o'clock at night.
Now, is this Lightning Lane stuff, this is on the Genie Plus app, or is it separate?
Correct. Everything's on the app.
Everything's on the app. Now, for Genie Plus, do I have to pay for the app?
No.
The app is free. Okay. And Genie is free too. What Genie is it's kind of like gives you suggestions of what to do. So it would do that for everyone if you want to do it. You could put in like your favorite attractions or what your like likes and dislikes are, and it's supposed to be smart enough to kind of recommend a nice day for you. Okay. I personally think it's BS.
But again, ish, I did want to meet Olaf.
Right. Like I'm not going to meet Olaf right now. Right. Man. You know, like,
the characters for me is a completely separate issue. That's another thing. Like, as not a Disney person, when they turned the characters into attractions that you have to wait in line for and can get, or could at that time get fast passes to meet the character, yep. I was like, this is, I'm not wasting a fast pass to meet Olaf. Why? Who would do that?
Yeah,
a lot of people that listen to this podcast do that.
Really? That's crazy to me.
But Epcot, I think Epcot, out of all the parks, have the most characters, especially in the countries, princesses too, you know, where they'll just be pop-ups. You know, you don't really know if someone is going to be there.
Do they still do pop-ups? Because I've never seen. Yep. I saw them the first year I went and never saw a pop-up again.
Now, yeah, they
want to meet characters.
Not really.
See, then you're off the hook there.
Yeah. I mean, even when she was 5, it wasn't really a big thing. We went to a couple characters, and she wasn't really thrilled or excited with it. And we were like, okay, fine. That's one less thing we have to worry about.
Yeah.
Do rides. I agree. Yeah.
That'll save you a lot of time right there, not waiting for characters.
Yeah. Right. So the other thing, though, John, is Genie Plus. And Genie Plus is $15 per person, and it gets you the option to reserve rides throughout the day.
Yeah, sorry, per person per day.
Per person per day.
So yep. Now,
and you don't have to get it for every day.
Right, but a family of 3 for 2 days, that's $90 for Genie Plus if we want to do it for both days.
Exactly.
On top of
individual lightning lanes
for tickets per day for the $500 for tickets for 3 people.
Yeah.
For the day, and the $18 per person
for lightning.
Guarantee the ride for Guardians of the Galaxy.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. So that's what you're going to be dealing with. Those are like the biggest changes that people get upset about.
And let's tell them too, other attractions are on Genie Plus, like, and they don't cost money, like Haunted Mansion, Pirates. So you can get a place in line for those the same way you could FastPass, but now it's Genie Plus.
Okay.
Yeah. And if you're smart about it and you do some research, you could have Disney Plus. Now I'm getting my
it's too many
streaming services mixed up. You could have Genie Plus really help you. Like, in reality, when I went in August, I bought it all, partly because of the show, partly because I wanted, you know, I wanted to get on all the attractions. And I was able to get on 6 attractions at Hollywood Studios.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Using Genie Plus. In the olden days, I would have only gotten 3. And then a couple cheap ones if I really wanted to later in the day. But really, it would be 3.
That's so, a fast pass.
You could get right, 3 the old fast pass. Right. Exactly. So, you have to ask yourself, was it worth me paying $15 and there was 4 of us, right?
Right.
So, I'm paying $60. Was it worth $60 to get an extra 3 fast passes than what I would have normally gotten back in the day for free? I don't know. That's a question that everyone has to answer for themselves.
You know, I think that's an individual thing for everybody. Because, like, for me, I was in April, and it was 5 out of 10 crowds. And I used the 120-minute rule, which we'll explain to you. And I was able to stack things all day long. So once I went to lunch, once I was done with lunch, I was able to hit 5 rides in a row. It's bam, 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 bam each day.
Yeah. But stacking is kind of impossible to do now because Disney has made some tweaks.
Yeah.
But I was able to do it where all 3 rides in Toy Story Land, I got back to back to back just by chance. And that was great. We did Toy Story Land in 20 minutes. We went on all 3 major attractions. You know.
What are the 3 in there? That's the Slinky Dog Coaster.
Slinky Dog, Midway Mania, which you've probably been on before. That's the Toy Story where you shoot.
Right, yes, yes.
And then there's Jay's favorite ride.
We've killed this joke. We're not doing this anymore.
We're not doing the joke anymore.
we can explain it to John, but we buried this joke a year ago.
Ailing Swirling Sauces, and if you take the initials,
everything to the abbreviations.
Okay. Yeah.
Uh-huh. We have made every single joke you could possibly make about.
We're not allowed to joke about it anymore.
We don't do it anymore. Yet.
We're so anyway, and that's not a major attraction. It's kind of crappy actually, right. But whatever. It is what it is.
There's a joke there, but I'm not taking it.
You're saying that. Hey, that's crappy? Is that what you're saying?
Right, yeah.
I'm not taking that. I'm not taking that low shot.
So, yeah. So you have to. Now, listen. You're going. Let's take Hollywood Studios, for example. Here are the attractions you have not been on yet. You have not been on Slinky Dog. You have not been on Ailing Swirling Sauces. You have not been on Millennium Falcon. You have not been on Rise of the Resistance. You have not been on Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railway. Am I missing any, Jay?
No, I can't think of any. I think that's that. No, but there's only like 8 rides in the park, and you just listed more than half.
But I've done everything in Toy Story Land.
What? Except you've been on Slinky Dog?
Been on Slinky Dog.
Oh, okay.
I've done my all bad. Of those.
Oh,
it's
okay.
Just
good.
The Star
good.
Wars stuff that I haven't
done okay. yet. So really, okay, so you've only been, so the two attractions in Star Wars Land and Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railway is the 3 rides that you haven't been on. So, okay, so.
My daughter loves the other two on the other side. The
Tower of Terror
and Tower of Terror. She definitely wants to do those. So
yeah,
that means there's 5 that I want to get done, that I would like to get done.
I think if you do it right, you're going to get those 5 done. The problem is Rise of the Resistance. It's still the number one ride in Disney. It's the same individual lightning lane as Guardians is. So it's going to cost you money if you do it.
Right.
I would probably suggest to pay for it.
Right.
That would be my suggestion. I think it's that good. I also think Guardians is that good.
Dan, can I make a suggestion?
Sure.
If you don't want to pay for Rise, this is my tip. Get to the park 1 hour before it opens. Because that way, when the rope drop for hotel guests starts in a half hour, you're at the front of the line before all of those other hotel guests get there. And so you can just, bam, skip right down there.
And you may wait an hour still.
Yeah.
But it's better than the 3 hours you'll wait later in the day.
Right.
And some people will then say, but Dan and Jay, I'm also waiting an hour earlier in the park. So theoretically, I'm waiting an hour then and an hour then. What's the difference? And the difference is park time.
Yeah.
You know, park time is...
Because you can get off that and then go straight to Millennium Falcon.
Yeah, you're right. Gaining talk time that way.
Yeah.
Right. See, now, before we started this episode, Dan, you didn't tell me anything about Genie Plus going into it. You just told me I'm probably going to hate it.
Yes. And
I have to say, I don't hate it.
Really? Wow.
I don't hate cool. it. And this is why. Because where I'm at in my life now, 10 years ago, I would have hated it. Right now, I'm in a spot where $90 for the 2 days to ride more rides to get everything in is not going to kill me. It's not mm-hmm. the end of the yeah. world. And I'm like, yeah, my daughter wants to ride these rides. I'm going to pay $90 to make sure she gets on all the rides. 10 years ago, I was not in that position financially, and I would have been right. like, you want me to pay $90 extra so I can get my kid yeah. on these rides? And I would have been furious. But now I'm in a more comfortable spot where I can say, it's $90 and it's for the kids' fun, so let's just do it.
So, well here's the deal. If you pay the extra for both Genie Plus and Rise, let's say, for staying right. sticking with Hollywood Studios, you're probably going to be able to get this stuff done, the five attractions that you want, and you are going to be a little bit more relaxed in the sense where, yeah, okay, you have to be at a ride at a certain time. But right. in between that time, you can do whatever you want. And that's right. that's like what you were talking about before. If you want to go and see One Man's Dream, which is an awesome like Walt Disney tribute thing, you can do that. If you want to go try to ride Tower of Terror again, you can do that. You know, whatever the case may be.
Do they still have the yeah. Muppet thing? Is that still
yeah,
there?
Of course.
Okay. I love that yeah. Muppet show.
Good. Because then you'll fit on this podcast, because that's the number one thing we try to save is the Muppets.
Are we bringing them on?
We may have an opening if Stan keeps acting the way Stan's been. I'm joking. Yeah, so, you know.
No, I think all the reasons you thought I was going to hate it are the reasons that I like it. And it's going to allow me, exactly like you said, it's going to be allow me to go to Disney and treat it like a vacation where I can relax. I don't have to have spreadsheets on the entire day.
Right.
I can
plan
this out a little bit on the app.
There's a little bit more that we haven't explained yet. How about we wait to...
I'll be honest with you, John. I thought I was going to hate it. And I used the 120-minute rule, and it works for me.
You got to explain that.
Yeah.
What's the 120-minute rule?
So here's the deal. Genie Plus, it's not like a free-for-all. You just get whatever you want. Like, that's not how it works.
Of course.
You have to book it throughout the day, different attractions, and they have to be available.
Right.
So your first booking
has to be open all the time, and I have to keep checking back.
Well, you have certain times where you could check. Yeah. First one being 7 a.m. the morning of, where you have to make, by the way, at midnight, you should make a decision on if you want Genie Plus or not.
Yeah.
Buy it at midnight because it's only available the day of. Okay. Then you got to get up at 7 a.m. to book your first attraction.
No, anyway, you have to get it before 7 because right at 7 o'clock, you've got tens of thousands of other people competing with you.
Okay.
Yeah. Where you have to then decide beforehand what attraction you want your first, quote-unquote, fast pass for.
Okay.
And then you're forced at whatever time Disney gives you.
Okay.
It used to be where you could change it. You could, like, pick a time, and that's what Jay was talking about, stacking. People would pick the end of the day. Because right. the next part of this is then you're allowed to do that every 2 hours after the park opens. So if the park opens at 9, you're allowed to make your second one at 11, your third one at 1, your fourth one at 3. But wherever you are in the park, you have to stop what you're doing in order to be, quote unquote, first in line at those intervals.
Okay. So I'm going to have to set an alarm on my phone.
That's what I did. I had an alarm set for 6:59, 8:59, 10:59, so that at the minute I could jump on.
Yeah. Now the only catch there is that if you are able to get it very early, like say you want Mickey and Minnie's, and you're able to get that at park opening or 10 o'clock, let's say, once you ride it, you could also book it right after you ride it. Technically, after you scan in.
What do you mean?
So if you get Mickey and Minnie's Railway, let's go with that. Right. That's going to be your first one to go. You're at the mercy of what's available. Okay, right. You may get 2 o'clock in the afternoon, but you may get 10 o'clock in the morning.
Right.
And if the park opens at 9, you're going to get done with Mickey and Minnie's before your first 2 hour time block ends.
Okay.
Meaning that you could then book it at that time, and a new time starts at that minute. So say it's 10:19 where you scan in, you could then book something else, and then you have to wait until 10:19, 11:19, 12:19, 2 hours after that to get your next one.
I scan myself in, and then the minute I scan myself in, I should be on the app looking for the next ride while I'm waiting in line.
But don't get confused, because some attractions have 2 touch points. So some people will try to do it after the first touch point, and it won't work, and be like texting Dan and Jay, why isn't it working? And we say, just walk another couple 100 feet and scan into the next one, and then you could do it.
Okay. This is a lot of work. This is very confusing, and I don't think I took enough notes. So I am going to have to, when this podcast goes up, I'm going to have to rewatch it and take notes of the podcast.
Yes.
When you put it up.
Yeah, exactly.
It's really one of those things, once you do it for a few hours, then you've got it down.
Yeah. Usually that first day is tough, I will say. The first time I used it, I was a little like wonky with it. You can also practice. You can go on it right now. Well, the park's still open? No. But we're recording this very late at night. So the park's not open right now. But tomorrow you can go on the app and just see what's available. It'll show you.
Okay. All right. I will do that, actually. Take a look at it.
Yeah, just to familiarize yourself with it and see how it is. And you know what we do? I mean, this is what I did. I watch a lot of YouTube videos where they show you how to do it beforehand, just so you know what you're doing. I listen to a lot of podcasts like this one that talks about it, and it preps you just for, you know, so you're not going in completely blind with how to work it.
What is the cell service like in the parks? Like, am I going to be out of signal somewhere and not going to be able to connect to it? Or
it's gotten a lot better.
Yeah.
And I did not have any problems. But one thing you should carry with you is an external battery.
If my app open all day, right.
And here's where the Magic Band comes in really handy too, because you don't have it, when you go to those touch points, you can just scan with your Magic Band, just like you scan into the park. You won't have to pull your phone out, pull the app out, and scan it that way.
That's probably new to you too, John. I'm not sure if it was on the phone last time.
There were the Magic Bands, and everything kind of charged back to your room.
Yeah, so those are Magic Bands, but now you have to pay extra if you want an actual band on your wrist. You could just use your phone, though, that works as a Magic Band, but you have to have the app open. So what Jay's trying to say is that, like, you could leave the phone in your pocket, pay the extra money for the band, and just scan it.
Swipe my wrist everywhere
it's
I go.
It's still a really convenient thing, and you can find them on eBay for cheap.
Yeah. Yeah, and they still sell the solid color ones, so like just basic old school ones, and those are only $10. So it's not the craziest thing. Now, the newest thing is Magic Band Plus, which is the new fancy, and that's what Jay talked about before.
What do you get with Magic Band Plus? Is it just lights and
it lights up?
It lights up. There's 50th right now. There's 50th anniversary statues throughout all the parks, and if you go past them and you wave your hand, they'll like talk to you. Statues.
Okay.
They're adding a bunch of games right now in the Star Wars area. You could do like bounty hunting, and there's all like you go to different things and you wave your band and it like does stuff for you. You know. So and that's what they're trying to add. There are a lot. I think John, did you play back in the day in Epcot the it used to be Kim Possible, then it game, then it was Agent P, Phineas and Ferb. You know what I'm talking about?
Okay. No, the The only thing I'm thinking of is I don't know why I get their names backwards. Buddy and Wuzz. Woody and Buzz.
Yeah. No, that's an actual
Buzz Lightyear thing.
Yeah.
No.
This was a game where you could pick a country in Epcot. Right. So you go to, let's say, England, and it'll say, "Hey, go to the red phone booths." You know, the red phone booths. You go in there and you press like a certain code, and a golf ball rolls out of the phone, and that like triggers like something else to happen. Okay. And you go to that, and that triggers something else to happen. It was a cool, like, scavenger hunt thing.
Yeah.
Apparently, well, the rumor is that they're bringing that back in a Magic Band Plus form, where you're going to use your Magic Band.
Okay.
Well, they've been saying that for 3 years, so we'll see.
Yeah, they've been saying that forever. And they're changing it to DuckTales, we've heard, but who knows what's going to happen.
Let's change it to DuckTales.
That game. Whole game is gonna be DuckTales. It used to be Kim Possible when that was popular. Then it turned to Phineas and Ferb. There'll probably be a new theming when it comes
back. DuckTales has come and gone. The show's been canceled.
I know. That's the thing. Now DuckTales is gone, so.
I will tell you that I heard a great joke today. The babies who were born when Tron was announced will be old enough and tall enough to ride it when it opens.
So that's the new attraction, John, in Magic Kingdom is Tron, which we will not be going to. But
no, we're not going to do
Tron
that.
Tron has been being built for a long, long time now. Seems like forever.
Yeah. Okay.
Since Walt was alive.
And actually, Magic Kingdom, one of the reasons we're not going to Magic Kingdom is because of the how busy it's going to be. And Magic Kingdom is very, like, the streets are very narrow. So the crowds, a smaller crowd feels bigger in Magic Kingdom when you're trying to walk behind by It's a Small World and everything. Everything is narrower back there, and we're just avoiding that altogether.
That's a major design flaw that that they did. We talked a little bit about urban planning, but that is the biggest design flaw that Disney World has had, that area near Small World.
That pinch point is the worst.
Yep.
And honestly, you'll probably be a lot happier skipping Magic Kingdom on Thanksgiving.
Yeah. I'm not a crazy Disney guy, and I know that that's like a terrible place to be in all the parks. So I feel a little validated. Maybe I should be another host on your show.
Also, I would think that Thanksgiving Day, what's the name of the restaurant? I'm having a brain fart here. What's the restaurant?
Park.
That's in Magic Kingdom that has the all-you-can-eat turkey.
Oh, Liberty Tree.
Liberty Tree Tavern. Tree Tavern is probably like...
Yeah, they do
that day. Like,
Thanksgiving every day, so I can't imagine how bad it's going to be that day.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what the meal is all you could eat Thanksgiving dinner.
Nothing like eating a bunch of turkey to slow you down.
Right.
I've done it in July and when it was 110 degrees out and... literally had to go back to the room after we were done eating. I'm done with this day. But it's delicious. It really is good.
It is.
Now, that, speaking of food, well, before we end, we have to talk about food. You have to get on that pretty soon, John, as far as booking your dinners. And also, another thing, you have to book your parks. Do you know that?
Yeah, what is that about?
You have
this
to
is like I've seen online. I have to, once I make my reservation with the hotel, I then have to book. Once I buy the tickets, I then have to check availability to book the parks for that day. They limit the amount of people in the parks.
Yeah, that is true. Yep.
Okay.
And once you go to purchase tickets, it's going to take you to a separate window, and you'll click on those days. And you're actually going to want to do that soon, like really soon.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because they sell out. And the biggest complaint we get from non-Disney geeks is, I just spent thousands of dollars on park tickets, and I can't go to the park because they're so...
And they won't and the tickets are non-refundable.
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic. Okay, so I'm going to do that probably once we hang up.
you may actually want to. And same with restaurant reservations. Yeah. I would definitely pick where you want to eat, how many meals you want to eat in the park, and get those booked right away because, again, Thanksgiving, it's all going to book up really fast.
Here's the thing with Disney Dining, John. I'm a I'm a big lover of the Disney restaurants. I honestly have had very few bad meals on Disney property. It's one thing that I think Disney does very, very well.
Yeah.
And most of the restaurants, most of the 100-something restaurants they have are not in a theme park. So for someone like you who is getting there on Wednesday, you could, if you want, you can go out to dinner on Wednesday. If you know, you could, or you could save some money and do something cheap, but you're probably going to want to go out to dinner on Thursday. And that's going to be a very popular day. You know, look to see what's available.
Right.
You'll find something. You just got to do it.
There's Disney Springs. There's the resort Disney hotels.
Right. Because I remember even 20 years ago, like if you wanted to eat dinner at the restaurant in Canada at Epcot, you had to book that 6 months out because you couldn't get it. And I fully don't expect to get into any of those. Maybe we'll have tacos outside of the taco stand.
They have no taco in Orlando. That's what I'm most looking forward to.
Disney Springs has added so many new places. I mean, it's like monthly they add something. Mm-hmm. So if worst case scenario, you go to Disney Springs, you can even actually spend the whole day at Disney Springs. Yeah. The joke on this podcast is that's my favorite park is Disney Springs.
Where is Disney Springs? What is I mean, what used to be Downtown Disney? Is that what that is?
It is, but they redid it all. It's completely different now. But it's cool, and it is your type of place, John. You will like it because you can walk around and drink, like, or just walking around. And
it's like Venice here.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's an open container town, like where I live?
Yeah. Open container, but it's all shopping. Shopping and drinking and entertainment. Okay. At night, they have bands playing all over the place.
And Dan, I would say, 99% of the restaurants there are fantastic. There's Planet Hollywood, which no one needs to go to.
Right. Yeah, right. That's probably the worst one. Yeah. We went to Chicken Guy for lunch, and I thought it was the best chicken fingers I've ever had in my life. I really did. I was like, this is so good. And even Connor said it. Connor was like, holy cow, Dad. This is so good. So there's places to go there. That might be a good idea to spend the day Thanksgiving
Day. Do they still do Disney meal plans that I can pay in advance or no? Everything has to be okay.
Yep.
We don't know when that's coming back. Point,
right?
What's that?
Yeah, we don't know when that's coming back at this point.
Yeah. Everyone wants it to come back. I don't know. We don't really know the reason why it's not there because we know for a fact that most of the time it's not worth it as far as money wise goes. Right. It's worth it because of convenience people do. Right. This last trip, just to have that convenience, I put $2,500 on a Visa card, like a gift card.
Right.
And I just handed that everywhere I went. And I felt like I could eat whatever I want. Because if I didn't do that and I was taking a dollar bill or a $20 bill out of my pocket, I would be like, all right, I'm getting the cheapest thing on the menu.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good plan.
So that's what I did, except for the part where it was my last of my 13 nights. And 13. Yeah, we went 13. And they told me that I had no money left. I was like, what? I spent $2,500 on food?
Wow. Well, in 2 weeks,
And that's lunch and breakfast,
Your entire family.
Starbucks
Starbucks snacks. I mean, you got to have the cheeseburger spring rolls at Magic Kingdom.
Yes, you do. That is the treat.
And it was food and what we did Food and Wine Festival, which was when I say Jackie and I did Food and Wine Festival, we did Food and Wine Festival. We went a little crazy. It was pretty awesome. So, anyway. What'd you think, John?
I feel like I learned a lot.
Do you have any questions?
It's a lot of information, and I honestly, it's too much for me to process right now to even get to a question.
Yeah.
I'm gonna hang up with you guys. I'm gonna bring my wife in. We're gonna sit at the computer. We're gonna book our restaurants and whatnot. My wife and my daughter. We're gonna be like, where do you want to eat? What parks do you want to go to? On what days? We're gonna plan that all out immediately because I don't want to get shut out of anything. And I definitely don't want to pay for park tickets and not be able to go.
And you can call Dan 24 hours. It doesn't matter if he's asleep.
Oh, yeah. I know that.
And this podcast will be in the interwebs forever for you to listen to, John.
Right. So I can go back to it and refer to it. All someone has to do
is Google your name and it'll pop up.
Oh, good.
Subscribe. Give us a 5-star rating. Share it with your friends. Grab your friends' phones. Your friends and your family grab their phones. Subscribe for them. They will love you for it.
But seriously, passengers, what we'd like you to do is comment in the notes and give John some advice. What did we miss? What did we miss? What does he need to know as a non-Disney fan? This is something that I think all crazy Disney fans deal with probably on a weekly basis of someone approaching us talking about Disney. And sometimes I feel like I just don't want to even get into it because I'm like, oh, it's not worth it. Like, depending on who they are, you know? Like, I don't know if I want to even have this conversation.
Depends on how much I like them.
Yeah, right.
I'm sure I have been that person a couple of times where I'm like, because a lot of things annoy me about Disney and you're a super fan and you don't want to have that conversation with me because I'm annoying and I'm a jerk. I can be
Yeah, but we get it. Like, listen, this thing, everyone likes different things in life and we have accepted that Disney is something that brings us joy and we like to do and we have found an online Disney community that has been nothing but awesome to all of us. We just had, John, we just had a meetup in Orlando of almost 40 people. Then we had a meetup in LA a couple weeks ago that had, what, like 25 people after dinner? So, you know, it's a cool little thing we got going.
You know, we've made some really good friends that are like family now along the way. It's been a good, great journey.
Yeah.
Good.
Fun time.
That's awesome.
But anyway.
All right.
Passengers, let us know what we missed. Tell John
what else I need to know.
Recommend some restaurants for him. John, you could change those as you go along. Is he doing the right thing by staying at Caribbean Beach? Or would you rather stay at Port Orleans? It's a toss-up for me. I like the Skyliner, though, so I guess you sold me on that. I think Liv will love it, by the way. I think she will.
I think it'll be super convenient to the two parks that we want to go to. So that, And I think she'll
love
it.
It's like the first ride of the day.
Right.
Yeah.
Haven't even gotten to the park yet, and we're getting on a ride.
And you could actually ride the Skyliner around. It's free, right? So you could even do that on Thanksgiving Day and just take a ride and go around and see what's around, you know?
Yeah.
So that's another
cool
thing.
Get some pictures of the park and stuff like that. And actually, I know you're trying to wrap it up. Where Caribbean Beach is on Thanksgiving, if we sit in the right spot, we can see the fireworks from Epcot. Because I know I've stayed in another place.
Yeah.
I stayed in Bonnet Creek, where you can see the fireworks from the balcony of Bonnet Creek.
Mm-hmm.
So
you could see there's a ton of places to view fireworks. I mean, you can go to the Poly and stand on the beach. I mean, just everywhere. We watched the fireworks. We had our group got a house at Margaritaville, and Connor's balcony from his room. He had his own balcony, my son, that he could see Everest and Tower of Terror and fireworks from all parks, you know.
Right.
Yeah, I was fine until you said you could see Tower of Terror. I just rubbed salt in the room. Rubbing salt in that.
I gotta be honest with you. We had, there's, I don't know, 4 or 5 bedrooms and each had their own balcony and we all like picked our rooms and then my son's like, "Hey Dad, I think I can see Tower of Terror from my room." And I'm like, "Get out, kid. I want this room." So really cool. But anyway, passengers, follow us along on Facebook, Magic Ticket Holders group, or come join the fun on Instagram. Holly just put up a reel that overnight got over 10,000 views. So very cool. Some pretty cool things going on with the water bottles in Tomorrowland. There's a little tease. Go check our Instagram page to see what that's all about. Live shows every Monday night on Facebook Live. Jay, I think you're next week.
I'm hosting next week. Yeah. Me, Chris, and I think Holly again.
All right. Oh, yeah. Beatrice is on a cruise.
Holly, if you're hearing this, I've just volunteered you.
Come check us out. Join the phone. Everyone, have a great rest of your week. And Ken, take it away.
The Grand Circle Tour podcast is brought to you by Expedition Roasters. When you visit expeditionroasters.com, use the promo code Grand Circle Tour Podcast. That's all one word, and you'll receive 10% off of your order. If you would like to keep the adventure going after the show, be sure to like our Facebook friends page, Grand Circle Tour Magical Ticket Holders. While you're on Facebook, like our group page, Grand Circle Tours. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, Grand Circle Tour Podcast, as well as Instagram, GCT Podcast, and our YouTube channel, Grand Circle Tour, and on TikTok at Grand Circle Tour Podcast. That's all one word. If you would like to email us, drop us a line at gctpodcast@gmail.com. T-shirts and other fun merchandise can be found at tpublic.com. Simply search Grand Circle Tour Podcast. If you enjoyed your adventure, leave us a review on Apple Podcast. Only one rule, make it good. All logos, sounds, songs, and music that are made by and for Disney and its affiliates are owned in full by the Disney Corporation and are not, nor are they intended to be owned in any way by the Grand Circle Tour Podcast. Thank you for riding with us, and welcome home.
Please exit to your left by stepping away from the cars with your left foot first. Step out and stand on the moving platform, please.
Please exit by stepping away from the cars with your left foot first. Step out and stand on the moving platform, please.